You are listening to Divided Podcast with Tilo and G Lee.
And I'll laugh with my third Super Bowl ring.
Take that and shove it up your own way.
Check us out on Spotify and Instagram.
It's three straight wins, but it's not three straight years of losing to a team.
It's not 3 years. It's more like 300 years.
Okay, whatever.
What is going on, everybody? This is Divided Podcast number 45, the Gary Francis episode. Let us not stop. Let us not do anything besides go straight into it. My gosh, Justin Fields traded for a sixth-round pick to the Pittsburgh Steelers.
We don't pay bills here? We don't pay bills here? Just because you're going to go troll me today doesn't mean we don't pay bills.
Oh, man.
Absolutely not. I'm going to make sure we do the right thing and let y'all know that this is the Divided Podcast on freaking Spotify. And we are on social media,
that
on
felt
Instagram.
So good.
Follow us at Divide Pod on Instagram. Follow us at Divided Podcast number 2 on Twitter/X. And don't forget to subscribe on Spotify. Whew. Where you can find this Divided Podcast with Tilo and G Lee. Don't forget to hit us up. Again, we are on Spotify. Y'all cannot forget where you can find us. It is the Divided Podcast.
If you thought that was bad, just wait until I get to our baseball segment, how we start off that. We got to start off with it because Tilo just wants to say everything off his chest about this. And I just want to gloat on how right I was about this as well. That Justin Fields is not going to be the Bears quarterback. That he got traded to the Pittsburgh Steelers, and I told you that they were going for Caleb Williams, and you tried to tell me I was wrong.
I didn't say that. What are you talking about? I said I didn't want that. I said I did not want Justin Fields to be gone because he is the guy, and there was help. That's what I said.
Yeah.
So calm down.
Yeah. All right.
You got a little intro for me? You got something to play?
No, I don't. That's it. Okay. Right. I don't have anything for you.
By the way, shout out to our TikTok viewers, by the way. LiveWave Agency has said hello. Also, shout out to I Love Fashion. Hello. Welcome into the live stream chat here on TikTok. Anybody, by the way, we are recording a podcast, but we are also live on TikTok. So any comments on TikTok live, man, hit us up. Any sports questions or anything we're talking about, man, please comment, like, share the live. Make sure you guys tune in. We are going to be interacting with you as we record the podcast. But hello to everybody. Like, share. We love y'all, man. Marlene, welcome into the feed. All right.
Fields' time is up in Chicago. It's looking like the Bears are going to be drafting Caleb Williams, man, with that first overall pick. Polls did right by him. It was announced that 4 or 5 other teams were looking for his services.
Yeah.
And Justin did not want to go there. You know, maybe the market was set or higher with those 4 or 5 other teams. Maybe Seattle, maybe New York Giants, maybe Arizona Cardinals, whoever it might have been. Justin wanted to go to Pittsburgh, and he got his wish. And the market was set there for that because Pittsburgh was not going to give up any other than a 6th-round pick for him because Mac Jones got traded for a 6th-round pick as well. So the market was set. Bears fans, I'm sorry. That's what you weren't going to get out of him anymore.
Just bad. Just bad, bro. Everything you just said was bad. Everything you just said was bad. And it really breaks my freaking football sports heart of the fact that, yes, you wanted to do by Justin, and I know that Justin Fields wasn't your guy. And Poles, honestly, I don't think Poles did anything wrong in regards to doing right by him. It's just what we got back in return. But in my heart of hearts, Justin Fields with this freaking core around him?
It's not going to happen.
DJ on the left, you could have gotten Marvin Harrison on the right.
Just dreaming,
you got Komet. You got Swift behind you. Like, the O-line was playing so much better. And now watch. You already know what's going to happen. If Justin doesn't get traded from the Pittsburgh Steelers before the season starts, he's going to come in at some point in the middle of the season, and what's going to happen? He's going to be a starter.
I don't think that's going to happen. I think the reason why they traded him because he wasn't working out. And if we really want to do that type of game where we're going to look, oh, it's Justin, here's what's going to happen. Justin's going to go to Pittsburgh. He's going to ball out, and then everything's going to happen. Do we really? I don't really think. Good. Look at, okay, if we just go down the list of the Bears quarterbacks, Mike Tomczak, Jim Harbaugh, Eric Kramer, Shane Matthews, Cade McNown, Jim Miller, Rex Grossman, Craig Kensel, Cordell Stewart, Kyle Orton, Rex Grossman, Jay Cutler, Mitchell Trubisky, Chase Daniel, Nick Foles, Andy Dalton.
Let's get Caleb. Let's add him to the list.
Adding him to the list, but the notion of like he's going to go and succeed elsewhere, it's just like we can't really say that's going to happen because I read you off that list of everybody since like 1984. And they didn't succeed after they left Chicago Bears.
I will tell you, Justin Fields is
the whole notion about Justin Fields. I understand Justin Fields is so much better than all these other quarterbacks that I just listed out. Yeah, he's better than Trubisky.
Eric Kramer, right?
Eric Kramer, Shane Matthews.
He's better than all of them.
Steve Walsh, we'll go down the list, whatever it is, but they didn't succeed after this. Jay Cutler didn't succeed afterwards, you know, exactly. But the notion of like Justin is going to ball out in Pittsburgh, you can't really say that is the case. Can't really say that's the case because recent history has shown when they leave the Bears, it doesn't mean they're going to succeed elsewhere. Same thing with coordinators. When they leave Chicago, it doesn't mean they are absolutely going to suck elsewhere. It doesn't really matter.
Question for you.
What?
Caleb throws a 70-yard dot today in his
workout. Oh, yeah. His pro day was awesome. Okay. Like, he was throwing very, very well. And guess who was there? Ryan Poles. Yeah. And guess who else was there? Matt Eberflus. Well,
they're going to draft him. Duh, that's not an issue. But I'm asking you a question. Are you impressed that he does that without pads and without pressure? Or are you impressed?
Are you trying to be like, every other quarterback can do that stuff? Because I was impressed.
I'm asking you.
I'm impressed. I'm very impressed by Caleb Williams.
Okay. All right.
The ability to play football, Caleb Williams, as a quarterback, yes.
Zach
I am
Wilson
impressed.
Did the same thing in his in
there we go. I should have known you were going to do
did.
That.
Did he not?
I should have known.
But did he not? Am I speaking facts or am I not? It's you know, everybody has an arm when you come in. Any guy who's doing the workouts, they got an arm, right? They're throwing 60, 70-yard passes. So, I'm not impressed by that. I really need to see, what do you do under pressure? What do?
And that leads me to my next topic. Caleb Williams can go in, win you guys 12 games, throw for 30 touchdowns, 4,000 yards, something Justin Fields never did in his freaking career in Chicago Bears. That's why he got traded. His ass got traded and moved on to Pittsburgh because he couldn't get the freaking job done. He only won 10 games in his whole career. And don't give me the sorry-ass excuse that he didn't have the team around him. Mm-hmm. What happened in Chicago happened in Chicago. What's set in stone is that record.
Sure.
Sorry about it, but that's what happened.
And that's why.
So what's going to happen is that he could do all this stuff, all the great stuff, and everybody's going to cry and say, Justin's still our guy, QB1, Justin Fields, when he's over on another team. No, it's ridiculous.
So you're the same guy that said Patrick Mahomes wouldn't be the same quarterback with the Bears, right?
No, he wouldn't.
Exactly.
Same thing if he with the Seahawks. The same thing with the Cardinals.
Exactly.
Same thing with
you
the Vikings.
You need help. My whole premise of everything I've been saying in the offseason, you need help.
Okay.
He didn't have any. That's why he didn't win games.
Sure. He didn't have any help.
And he lost three off the defense. It wasn't because of him.
We're going to fight about this forever. But the fact of the matter
we're
is.
We're going to find out this year who's right. That's what we're going to find out.
I was right. I said Caleb Williams was a quarterback for the Chicago Bears in 2024, and I was right.
That was obvious.
Yes.
Don't be happy about that.
I am happy about
it. Saying 1+1
I'm extremely
is 2,
happy about it because I was sick and tired of all these people saying Justin can be this, Justin can be that, and he didn't. And now you got a guy that could potentially do that. You should be happy. You restart the clock. You don't have to pay $200 million for a bum that only won you 10 games in 3 years, and it had a top 10 receiver on the outside and a top 10 tight end on the inside as well, and he couldn't get the job done. And now you say, oh, he's our guy, but he'll still win you 7 to 8 games every year, and you want to pay him $200 million for that?
I'm going to tell you he's our guy, Justin. I mean,
he's not
our
your guy anymore. He's not your guy anymore.
He's not, but I'm going to tell you that he should have been our guy until Caleb proves me otherwise.
Nope, he proved you otherwise because he's not your guy, and he got traded.
Let me tell you, if Caleb is horrible, if he's bad in year one, okay. We have to give him a leeway because he's a rookie. He's a rookie quarterback. You got to give him a chance. That's the routine that we do. That's what the Bears do. Yeah, rookie quarterback. Okay, boom. Then the next year comes. Oh, showed a little bit of a progress. It's a never ending cycle. And I pray, G, that does not happen with this guy.
Sure.
Because I'm going to tell you in your face, Jay was the freaking guy for this roster. We just let him go for nothing. For nothing.
Because he was worth nothing.
Bubblegum, bro.
Because he was worth nothing.
And that's wrong. That's wrong.
No.
He's worth more than what they say.
Okay. Then why did he want to go to Pittsburgh? Because Pittsburgh was only offering that 6th-round pick. If he went to Seattle, if he went somewhere else, he went to Houston, didn't matter where else. He could have got a better value, but he didn't.
Well, his value just went down by day.
He chose his value. He chose to go to Pittsburgh, and Pittsburgh was only offering him the 6th-round pick, and it's shown, but he could have gone elsewhere, and the Bears could have gotten better return. But he chose to go to Pittsburgh, that's why Poles honored him. He did right by him, but he also screwed himself in a business sense because he only got a 6th-round pick. You can blame Poles for that because right.
And I will.
He did right by Justin, but Justin was only worth a 6th-round pick because that's the only team he wanted to go. So if you want to blame anybody, blame Justin for screwing the Bears over where that. Okay? Don't be pointing the finger at Poles for that. He did right by him, so blame everything on that 6th-round return on Justin Fields.
I'm gonna blame,
which is hard for you to do because Justin is never at blame for anything.
No, of course, no. Justin,
we need to move on because we talked about this enough.
Justin's not at blame for this, and I will blame Ryan Poles if this doesn't go right because he let him go for nothing. It doesn't. I don't care what the market said. You let that man go for a freaking. I'm just like, bro. This is the one position in this organization that is never right. And you continue what he's doing is the same ship that we do every freaking four years.
It's a podcast. You can say what you want.
You're right. We're not FCC regulated. Shit.
That's probably going to be the best part of the podcast,
dude. This is the one thing we need.
Last thing I'll say is that I was right about this.
Look, you were right, but they're wrong. That's the bottom line.
Congrats, you got no quarterback, and you're about to get Caleb Williams. Awesome. We got to move on to other big news in the NFL. We're not going to talk about every single free agency signing. We're going to talk about highlight some of the bigger free agency signings, like the Ravens signing Derrick Henry to a 2-year deal worth $60 million. You have Lamar Jackson and Derrick Henry in the same backfield. That is absolutely dangerous.
I got a question for you about this.
If they give him 6 carries in the AFC Championship game, I will be absolutely furious. That you cannot go in an AFC Championship game, only give Derrick Henry 6 carries and expect to win the ball game. Absolutely not.
Shout out to Rookie, who's on the TikTok chat, by the way. Hello, amiguito.
I will lose my mind.
Latrell, welcome into the TikTok chat. I see you, man. Give us a shout out, man. Let us know what you want to talk about. Question for you, Ravens fan. Do you think Derrick Henry and Lamar, this thing is
going to
work?
Yes, I think it's going to work. I think that Derrick Henry is going to the most perfect spot to run the football. It's a team that in the past 3 years has been either 1 or 2 in rushing, and Derrick Henry has been one of the best. I'm not going to say he is the best because obviously that's Christian McCaffrey right now. I would say Derrick Henry in the past 5 years has been the best or one of the best running backs, and the stats will prove it, touchdowns, whatever. Derrick Henry is a monster. I don't want to hear the whole wash thing. He's just turned 30.
I agree that with everything you're saying right now, which is weird. But I Derrick Henry's a freaking dog.
Yeah, I'll say he's going to have an awesome season. Ravens obviously are going to have to bolster up the offensive line because they lost 2 guards and a tackle during this free agency period. So they'll bolster up that. Derrick Henry is going to run. And if he doesn't run in the AFC Championship game, I'm going to lose my mind. Falcons signed Kirk Cousins to a 4-year, $140 million deal. Who the hell is this agent? How the hell is Kirk Cousins getting all these money deals, man?
Bro. I couldn't believe when it first came out, I had to do a triple take. I'm like, there is no way this Kirk just... He released $180 million?
The
4-year deal? That's crazy, bro.
The fact of him signing with the Falcons isn't surprising because a lot of people said it was going to happen, but the fact that he signed for $140 million, $180, $140, whatever, guaranteed, whatever, absolutely freaking nuts.
Latrell on TikTok says, how does Kirk keep finessing?
Ask Sam Bradford because he did the same thing for the Rams, the Vikings, the Eagles. They must have the same agent or something like that.
Man.
Speaking of the Eagles, Saquon Barkley signed a 3-year deal worth up to $38 million. Dead to me, Tilo. You're dead to me.
Another one. That's crazy, dude.
Speaking of the Eagles, they got Kenny Pickett in a trade. And some more running back news. Josh Jacobs signed with the Packers. Man, that they got a upgrade.
Man.
They released Aaron Jones. He later signed with the Vikings. But I think Josh Jacobs with the Packers is a really, really good fit.
Huge.
Speaking of good fits. Huge. Speaking of good fits. Chris Jones signs the largest extension for a defensive lineman in NFL history, signing back with the Chiefs. Speaking of the Packers, Xavier McKinney going there for 4 years, $68 million. They lost Jonathan Owens to who? The Bears. So he goes and, you know, fills up that slot. Gus Edwards signed with the Chargers. Geno Stone signed with the Bengals. Austin Eckler and Bobby Wagner go and sign with the Commanders. Zach Moss signed a 2-year deal with the Bengals. And then right after they did that, the Bengals... absolutely stunner move. Trade Joe Mixon to the Texans, man.
Yeah, man. Wow. I'm sure you were happy.
No, I mean, that's great. I mean,
he said that's great.
I mean, the Texans got a top 10 running back, and that's what they really, I mean, if you watch the divisional game against the Ravens, they could not run the ball, and that was like their only thing probably that was holding them back.
The Texans have a top 10 team right now.
Oh, yeah, I agree with you, because what we're going to talk about next is Danielle Hunter goes and signed with the Vikings, man. Yeah. They lost a lot of guys in free agency, but they go and sign big guys. They get Joe Mixon, they get Hunter in there. Man, that was really good. All right, with the Steelers.
I'm laughing at one right now. Please get to it.
The Steelers sign Patrick Queen. I knew it was going to happen. I knew he was going to leave the Ravens. But man, why you got to go sign with the Steelers, man? Why you got to sign with the Steelers?
I almost retweeted your tweet and said something really mean to you. But I was
honestly,
I like my guy.
Derrick Henry signed with the Ravens at 11 a.m. At 1 p.m. that day, Patrick Queen goes signed with the Steelers. Oh, yeah. It was so heartbreaking. You know, I'm going to miss him. You know, he got his money. He had some disputes with some people on social media about it, and he's like, look, I'm a Raven, through and through.
Yeah.
I bled for your city for 4 years. I tried everything I could. You know, I still love the city of Baltimore. It's just different with certain organizations like New England, Baltimore, I would say San Francisco. You're a part of that organization, and you're kind of a part of it until you retire. You know, people Jared Johnson, who didn't play much with the Ravens, they legit come back all the time to do Ravens stuff. So, that's really cool to see, certain organizations like that. Speaking of the Steelers, Deontay Johnson traded to the Panthers. Can you name me one receiver in that group besides George Pickens right now for the Steelers?
I can't.
You obviously see what they're going to do in the draft. Chargers are going to keep Khalil Mack and Joey Bosa, but they trade Keenan Allen to the Bears.
What a shocker, man. That was the one move. I was like, Keenan Allen?
That was done before they traded Justin Fields, so it's like, okay, maybe they do it. Nope, skirt. We're getting rid of him.
The only thing I'm worried about with Keenan is that his fall off happens right now, because he's 32 right now.
He just came off his best season, though.
That's my point. He came off his best season. Now the fall off starts to happen, and we got him. That's the only thing I'm worried about. I pray that Caleb and these guys make it happen, but yeah, that's the only thing I'm worried about. But Keenan is a dog.
He's a dog.
He's a dog. And it was exciting news.
One of the most underrated receivers in the NFL right now. Yes. Somehow the Saints lifted up a rock and found this extra money lying around, because they signed Chase Young to this huge $15 million deal for 1 year. It's just dude, I think I saw one time they had $134 million underneath the cap space. They owed $134 million. How the hell are you signing Chase Young to this lucrative contract right now?
Desperate.
And they're eating up Derek Carr's contract too, which is just crazy. Oh, Devin White signs with the Eagles. Mike Williams signs with the Jets.
That's the one I want to say.
You want to talk about that one?
I don't want to talk much about it. It's just Mike Williams, man. The Jets.
Don't worry, he'll be killing it for 3 weeks and then tear his Achilles.
Listen, the Jets just cannot win at this game, man. They can't win as an organization, bro. Dude, they make all the bogus moves.
I saw a tweet that said, who's stopping Aaron Rodgers, Garrett Wilson, and Mike Williams? And then somebody tweeted, the turf at MetLife.
I mean, it's just so bad. Latrell on TikTok says the Jets are cursed.
They are cursed. There's some cursed organizations like the Lions, the Browns, but the Jets are up there, man. Definitely are. Bad. Leighton Vander Esch retires from the NFL, and a big one, Aaron Donald retires from the NFL. Is he the greatest defensive player of all time?
Man, all time? I mean, numbers-wise, he's top five for sure. I mean,
I put him at two, man. I put him right behind Lawrence Taylor.
Lawrence Taylor, Reggie
Ed Reed,
White.
Ray Lewis.
If Reggie White played longer, you know, it's hard. But he's in conversation.
I think those five, six guys we mentioned, Ed Reed, Ray Lewis, Reggie White, Lawrence Taylor, Aaron Donald, those five guys, you could definitely make a case all five of them are the top five players of all time.
I mean, don't be disrespectful to Dick Butkus now.
I'm not disrespecting him.
Because he's in that conversation too.
Sure. If we're going top 10, we can go, you know, Dick Butkus. We can go, go
Dick
Willie
Butkus could be a top five.
Willie Lanier.
Just saying.
NFL competition committee. You're trying to talk Bears right now. You're trying to heal yourself now.
I'm just saying.
You're trying to heal yourself before you go to break.
I'm just saying. You cannot disrespect Dick Butkus. It's Dick Butkus, man.
I'm not.
Okay, all right. Just making sure.
I wouldn't disrespect him or Gale Sayers.
Shout out Yoda says Cash Money on the TikTok Live. What up, Yoda? Sorry, go ahead.
Okay. NFL Competition Committee is proposing a rule to drop the hip tackle that is an automatic first down and a 15-yard penalty. This came into question on a Thursday night football game between the Bengals and Ravens when Logan Wilson hip tackled Mark Andrews in that Thursday night game, and he broke his fibula and tore three ligaments in his ankle. And that's when the whole conversation started up about, should we ban the hip tackle? Tony Pollard also got hurt from this injury in a game against the 49ers.
Yeah.
So let me get your take. I think that it's going to be really hard. It's just like the helmet to helmet for years and years. Players knew how, like, they were just so used to using their head to make tackles. And then it took like a really long time for players to stop using their head when it came to tackling. Now it's like you can't use your weight to make a tackle. So it's just like, that's really tough. Another one is just like, you know, not landing your weight on the quarterback and making a sack.
So, I mean, points per game are going up again by three.
Sure.
After this rule. And it's going to be, it's harder to tackle. And the quarterback is the most protected guy out there right now. And you blow some bad breaths to him, and it's going to be a penalty. It's bad. It's just what it is, what it is.
Last thing we're going to talk about for the NFL is that the draft is coming up in little over a month. So stay tuned for our next couple of episodes. We're going to be dropping our mock drafts in the next couple of weeks. Yep. We're going to take a quick break, but when we come back, do you smell it, Tilo?
I smell it.
It's baseball time, baby. I got baseball back on the Divided Podcast. Back here on Divided Podcast, we're going to talk some baseball. Oh, it smells so good.
It does.
8 days away. We're 8.5 days away from baseball, man.
Calm
tomorrow,
down.
We're going to be...
Don't be saying Cub players' names.
Tomorrow, we're Stansby Swanson days away from first pitch. Don't worry, we're Bo Jackson days away from first pitch. How about that?
Calm down. Calm down.
Well, technically, we're not... First pitch already happened in Seoul. But first pitch... For us baseball fans.
Don't forget to follow us on social media, Instagram, Divide Pod, Twitter, Divided Podcast number 2, and on Spotify, the most important one, man, subscribe on Spotify. Look us up, the Divided Podcast with T-Lo and G-Lee. We are there. Be square. Be there. All right.
All right, man. So I got a bone to pick before we get to there. Last Saturday night, Derek's birthday. Derek, happy birthday. 48 Derek's years young, my guy.
What's up, D?
Still looking good. Looking like a 24-year-old.
You look young, man. You do look young. He doesn't think he does, but he really does.
You look
young.
Good, man. You look good. We were out Saturday night celebrating his birthday, and I said something. I said, Tilo, I'll make a bet with you. If the White Sox win 80 or more games, which is like way above their season expectation, I said, I would buy a Frank Thomas jersey, a White Sox jersey. Now, I said, if the Cubs win 90 or more games, this man had to buy an Ernie Banks jersey. And he didn't do it. I was going to be a man and honor the bet. But this man couldn't even honor his own bet.
I have PTSD from 16, bro. I can't do it. I had to wear a jersey all day.
Awful.
On the day after you guys won.
I don't
won.
Care. It's, you couldn't honor that side of a bet?
I have scars in the back of my
You could have seen me in a White Sox jersey, dude.
Dude, that would be disgusting. Couldn't honor don't ever bet. Wear our jersey ever, bro. Don't do it.
There's a certain word I'm trying to think of. It starts with P, but I'm not going to say it. I know what word you think. I know what word I'm going to say.
I can't do it.
I'm not
going to
say it based on an honor of our friendship, but you're definitely it.
We can make a different one. I'm wearing the Lamar one for you, bro. So
but you don't hate the Ravens like you hate the Cubs.
I don't hate the Ravens. I
know exactly. I'm just saying you it could have been nice to see in that
pinstripe. To be honest, it's not a good bet. It's not a good bet. We're not going to win 80 games. So screw you and
so
move
wait,
on with
are you
the
saying there's a more realistic chance for the Cubs to win 90 games? Than the White Sox
yes,
winning any games?
Obviously, yes. It's going to be a bad year, I think.
We got breaking news in baseball announced today. Dodgers fire Shohei Ohtani as interpreter amid allegations of a massive theft. The Los Angeles Dodgers interpreter for Shohei Ohtani was fired Wednesday afternoon after questions surrounding at least $4.5 million in wire transfers sent from Ohtani's bank account to the booking operations set off a series of events. What? Ipe Minhoza, I butchered it. I'm sorry. The longtime friend and interpreter for Ohtani incurred the gambling debts of a Southern California bookmaking operation that is under federal investigation. Multiple sources announced that how come he came to lose his job, starting with reporters asking questions about the wire transfers. Oof. If the Dodgers didn't want, this is the worst way to start a season, is having a big scrutinizing scandal happen right before your season starts.
I mean, first of all, screw that guy, bro.
Like, so $4.5 million. Screw him,
bro. That's crazy, dog. Like, I get it, but like, no, you don't do that. Like, you're his trans, like, wow, bro, you got some balls. You got some balls.
You got some big, you got some definitely big
cojones.
Next thing I put on our rundown is we talk about our teams and what's been going on about the new development that has come up for the White Sox. Tilo, we'll talk about that. But first, we need to introduce what happened. That was Dylan Cease getting traded from the White Sox to the San Diego Padres.
You're just
having
a ball today, aren't you? This is yours.
Have you had a worse 4 days from Dylan Cease getting traded on Wednesday to Justin Fields getting traded on Saturday?
It's been so bad for a year that it's been numb to me. I've been numb. You seen me when I walked in on Saturday at the playoffs.
Let me announce the trade first. The White Sox gave Cease to the Padres in return for right-handed pitcher Drew Thorpe, a right-hand pitcher Jorge Arrieta, outfielder Samuel Zavala, not related to Sebi Zavala, and a right-handed pitcher Steven Wilson. Thorpe and Arrieta were the fifth and eighth ranked prospects, respectively. And now Tilo gets his turn to digress.
Okay. Yes, Dylan got traded, and we all knew it was coming. I'm not too mad at the trade. I mean, we got some prospects, obviously, out the deal.
Jackson Merrill.
I mean, I know, but, you know.
That was the golden egg for the Padres.
I understand. But Thorpe, is, you know, his numbers were great in spring training. Steven Wilson has been, he's proven himself in the majors and has had a backdrop as well. But, listen, I would have loved. In a perfect world that doesn't exist for the White Sox, but in a perfect world, I would have loved to see Dylan stay on the team for at least a month, see what the team was looking like, see if there was anything that we can maybe have some promise on, build off of, and then make that trade. But Chris, I mean, Getz is just saying let's
run. You get fleeced by Getz, huh?
Let's go. Let's
you
just
got
run
fleeced
it
by Getz, huh? And
I'm praying to the Lord.
You better pray hard, my guy.
Because Garrett Crochet is our starter.
Garrett Crochet, man. It went from Dylan Cease to Garrett Crochet.
But listen, Garrett Crochet had a freaking spring training. He had, for sure, man. He balled out.
What did I text you every time the Cubs beat the White Sox in spring training? It was spring training, man. Relax. And what did we tell Ryan about Hector Neris? We told him relax. It's spring training, my guy.
Poor Ryan.
Ryan.
We love you, Ryan.
Ryan, we love you. Relax, man. It's spring training. 8 days away. We're Ian Happ days away from first pitch. Speaking of first pitch, well, they haven't announced who their opening day pitcher is, but Blake Snell signed a two-year deal worth up to $62 million with the San Francisco Giants. Man, this team is pretty much it's loaded back end. Like
Giants
hey,
are
this,
back.
It could be good. Matt
the Giants are back.
Hey,
I'm
Matt,
telling you that right now.
Matt
Dodgers
Chapman,
calm down.
Blake Snell, Jordan Hicks.
Dodgers got some competition.
Hey, I know the Padres and Dodgers. You know they're pretty much head to head for the NL West, but. Man, if the Giants team comes sneaking up like they did in 2021 where they won 107 games out of nowhere.
Bro, the West is stacked, bro.
It is stacked, man.
Diamondbacks, you're forgetting the Diamondbacks.
Diamondbacks just went to the World Series, man. They had the reigning rookie of the year, Corbett Carroll, man.
The Rockies, bro. Just kidding.
Shut up. Don't even get me started on the Rockies. Don't get me started on the Rockies. Brewers closer Devin Williams set to miss 3 to 4 months due to back surgery.
That sucks,
oh,
bro.
That sucks. That's that could brutal. Set them back for the entire season because if you lose about 15 to 30 of that saves attempts that Devin Williams could have had, that will set your season back, and you can't even recover in August and September. That's going to be killer.
It's going to be crazy.
Another killer is Reds second baseman Matt McClain may need surgery on his left shoulder. It could take him out for the rest of the season. We don't know.
Yeah.
Domingo Germán and the Pirates reportedly agreed to a one-year minor league deal worth $1.5 million. If we've seen the 2023 emphasis from bad of like the highs of highs to the lowest of lows. It was Herman throwing a perfect game against the Oakland A's and then getting legit kicked out of his own locker room.
Yeah.
Well, he was dealing with a lot of stuff. He had abuse. He was dealing with a lot of stuff personally, which really sucks. Hopefully he can be in Pittsburgh, have a more steady ground, and get back, because I would love to see him pitch again. Speaking of the Pirates, they signed a deal to Michael A. Taylor for 1 year. The Braves also have signed Adam Duvall to a 1 year, $3 million deal. And the Red Sox also add on a 6 year contract extension worth $66 million to Brian Bello. He's one of the guys that the arms for the Red Sox they're hoping could be the future for them. Speaking of the Red Sox, don't cringe too much, but Lucas Giolito having elbow surgery to miss very considerable time.
I feel horrible for Gio, man. Like, I think he's run into some series of unfortunate events.
Both professionally and personally, man.
Yeah, like, he's just, getting traded to three teams in less than a year. Like, he's been on three teams. It just sucks for him, man. And I think, honestly, he was, I wished good for him when he left, and...
Oh, this makes four because he went to the Guardians after he got traded to the Angels.
That's right.
So four.
Yeah.
So four. All right.
Get well, Gio.
All right. We're 8 days away, so we got to give our playoff predictions. We're going to run through this as quickly as we can, but knowing us and Tilo, that might take a while. So I'll start off by saying who I have for both conferences. In the East and the AL side, I have the O's. I don't see any drop-off from them. Even I see addition. You added Craig Kimbrell and Corbin Burns to that team, man. They won 102 games last year. I can see them winning 105 games this year, man. I think they're the best team in the AL this year. In the AL West, I have the Astros. I think it's going to be a very tight division. I think people are saying that the Rangers are still going to be there. I agree. And I think people are saying the Mariners are going to be there. And some people are picking the Mariners to take the AL West. I don't think so. I think you still go with the standard if there's a lot of people, throwing up who's going to win who and stuff like that. You got to stay with consistency, and the Astros are on top of it. Yep. Now, don't mind me on this one, okay?
Go ahead, bro.
Mind me on this one. In the AL Central, I have the Detroit Tigers winning the AL Central. Listen. Spencer Torkelson, Parker Meadows, Javi Baez, Riley Green, Jack Flaherty, Medea, AJ Hinch is coaching that team. I think they could definitely make some noise. And they finished the season pretty strong. If they can reach that potential, all better than anybody, if a young squad can reach this potential, they can be dangerous. And I think that I don't think the Twins are consistent. I definitely don't think the Guardians, the White Sox, and the Royals are consistent. So I'll just throw it out there and say the Tigers are going to take the AL Central. Wild card, Rangers, Yankees, and Rays. All right, for your AL side, who do you got?
AL East, I'm taking the Yankees. I think the Yankees are finally going to break out and really use what they've signed. They got Juan Soto. I think Juan's going to have a crazy year. And I think Aaron Judge, which later on I'll talk about, is going to have a freaking dumb year. He's going to be healthy again. AL Central, I'm taking the Guardians because they're the most proven team. They're the deepest team in the Central.
Can I ask you something real quick? Do you think Terry being gone is going to make a difference on that team?
Potentially, but I just think that they're just too deep. They're too deep in the division, so that's why I pick the Guardians. AL West, I'm picking the Rangers again. They haven't lost a bit. Like they're right there exactly where they want to be, and they've gotten better in my opinion. AL Wild Card, because I like to troll and do what I do. I'm putting the White Sox in that
slot. Oh, my God, dude.
Why are you laughing, bro? Oh, get back on the mic.
Dude.
I think the White Sox are going to have a crazy year, bro.
Their over-under is at 60.5.
And the AL is going to suck, bro. Bro, listen to me. The White Sox will get into the playoffs, the postseason, with a minus 500 record, bro.
I'm going to bookmark this.
Be
so
ready,
bad.
Dog.
I'm going to bookmark this.
That's fine.
So bad.
This is it. March 20th, right here at 9:09 p.m. Central Standard Time. It is happening, my boy. It is happening. The White Sox will win the AL wild card spot. And as soon as I say that, Rat gets on the chat. What up, Rat? Did you hear what I just said? I picked the White Sox for the AL wild card. I think they're going to have a better year. It's going to be a weird year, yo. It's going to be a weird year, but it's going to happen. It's going to happen. Listen, bro, I told you the lineup earlier. I told you.
Can you get through the rest of your wild card?
No, that's it. You said AL only.
AL wildcard. There's three teams that could be a wildcard team. You got the White Sox. Who else?
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I only put one team. But I,
oh my God, D-Lo. You can't follow instructions, man. No,
I don't like your lists,
dude. It's a wild card. Three teams make the wild card.
I'm gonna go Blue Jays. I think the Blue Jays are gonna AL East because they're always in it and get it out at the end. And the last team I'm picking is the freaking Orioles, bro. This Orioles team, bro, is this the year? This is the time. They're young still. But they have some experience, and I really do think that the Rutschman and all these guys are going to actually do some things. But the final slot, bro?
You already picked three teams. You picked the White Sox, you picked the O's, and listen, you picked...
The final team that gets into the postseason, bro, if this White Sox team finds some type of momentum at the very end of September, dog, and they're successful in mid-year, and they start maybe making some potential moves, even during a rebuild... Be careful.
I need a hotkey. Gorilla Monsoon had this thing where Bobby Heenan would just say the most ridiculous stuff. And he would say, will you stop it? I need a hotkey for you,
I'm trying to be
dude.
Serious as I say this, okay? So let me get through this.
Who's your second baseman? Who's your right fielder?
It's going to be DeJong. DeJong's our second base. Nice.
No. Yeah. Nicky Naperville Lopez is second base.
Nicky Naperville Lopez, baby.
All right, in the NL, so we can get to more serious stuff, it's the Braves, man. Like, yeah, dude, like they're the standard right now. And if they can get past the DS series, I can finally legit take them seriously. 102-win team right there. In the West, I got the Dodgers. That's another 100-win team. Like, nobody's stopping them right now. In the Central, I got the Cubs, man. I got the Cubs. If there's a team right now that is stacked for talent-wise and coaching-wise, I think it's the Cubs.
So you don't sound ridiculous right now?
Why would I sound ridiculous?
Rat rebuttal says it's going
to be the Cubs. Who cares what the hell Rat says?
Rat says the Cardinals are winning the Central.
No.
On TikTok chat.
Yeah, name me the five for the Cardinals, then I'll be scared. Anyway, for the wild card, I got the Padres, I got the Phillies, and I got the Giants, man. We just talked about them.
I think
they can make a run, dude. Honestly, they're very... dark horse team that I think could make the postseason.
Yeah.
I could throw in the Mets in there. I could possibly throw in the Reds right there. But I think if I want to throw in like a little wild card, I think I'm throwing in the Giants, man.
All right. You're crazy with Cubs in the NL. But Braves in the NL East for me. I got the Reds in the NL Central to win the division. This team has been striding up for the past 2 years. This is the year they do it. NL West, obviously the Dodgers. There's no questions about it. I got the wild card, you guys. The Cubs, the Phillies, and the Giants. That's what I got.
All right, let's move on to the awards. AL MVP, I am going to make a change. Choke, by the way.
We respect our TikTok viewers, and you Cubs are going to choke. Rat.
Nice, dude. Name me your starting five, and then I'll be legit scared.
Name your starting five card.
Yeah. All right. You're going to have a little trouble doing that. Anyway, AL MVP, I put Adley Rutschman there, but as soon as I started doing this, I think I'm going to change it to Corey Seager, man.
Ooh,
because
okay.
Corey Seager, if he can stay healthy, he is legit the best shortstop in the game. Go attack me with your other guys, but like Corey Seager, honestly, I think could put it all together and win MVP. The NL MVP, I know everybody's going to be picking Mookie Betts. I know everybody's going to be picking Ohtani because the Dodgers are stacked to be the best team in the NL. But there's one guy that plays first base for that team. Who's that guy? That's Freddie Freeman, man. He's one of the best first basemen in the game. He does not do good credit. Dude, he hit 200 hits last year. Do you know how hard that is in a season to get 200 hits? Bro, Freddie Freeman for MVP. All right, who are your two MVPs?
LVP, I'm going Aaron Judge this year, bro. I'm telling you, I think Aaron is going to, he's going to be healthy again, bro.
Does he break his own record?
I don't know if he breaks his own record. I just think he's going to have a freaking year.
All right.
He's going to be healthy.
Coming off an injury, be healthy, absolutely.
Yep. And on MVP, I had Freeman. It's not even, it's like.
Wow, we agreed on it.
Yeah. Freeman, bro. It's true. Like, he's a dog, bro.
He's a dog, man. He doesn't get his due respect because everybody looks at other guys, you know? But like, dude, like Freddie Freeman. Do we want to say he's the best first baseman in the game right now?
Dude, he's an automatic. You're an average 330 hitter. Like, he's going to make things happen for you, man.
I would say Matt Olson's the best first baseman in the game right now.
Rat says Paul Goldschmidt.
No. Matt Olson.
He says no. Rat, I'm sorry.
Matt Olson.
Get him later.
AL Rookie of the Year, which is crazy to me because I didn't even think this was possible. Evan Carter for the Rangers.
Oh, wow.
He was a September call-up, so he never played a full season. So he was absolutely vital for that Rangers in the World Series run. So I got him Rookie of the Year for the AL side. And then for the NL side, I have Yamamoto, the Dodgers pitcher, who's going to win Rookie of the Year for NL side.
NL for me, Yamamoto as well. I didn't pick an AL Rookie of the Year because I really don't know.
Okay.
I just really don't know who's going to be on the AL side.
Well, Evan Carter's a dog, so he's going to be a rookie still. We'll Gunnar Henderson last year, he was with the O's in 2022 as a, I want to say, August call-up, but he then translated 2023 into a rookie of the year. Okay. All right, Cy Young for AL. I got Corbin Burns, man.
Corbin Burns. That's solid.
The one thing the O's never had. They've had reliable infielders and outfielders with Austin Hayes, Cedric Mullins, Anthony Santander, Ryan Mountcastle, Gunnar Henderson, Adley Rutschman behind the plate. The one thing they did not have was starting pitching. And if Corbin Burns unlocks that 2021 potential he had in Milwaukee, watch out, because he's winning the Cy Young. Yep. And then the NL side, I have Spencer Strider.
Spencer Strider, okay. You know what's crazy? So I have the same AL Cy Young. I'm gonna say a name out here. I think he can bounce and do this. And I'm going Max Fried.
Max Friedy?
I think he's gonna do it. I think he has the.
Hold on. Max Fried for the Braves.
Yes, Fried from the Braves.
Okay, I thought you said Friedy.
No, Max Fried.
I thought you were talking about Eric Friedy. I was like, you need to settle down over there.
No, Max Fried from the Braves.
Okay.
Fried. I mean, he's a proven guy. One two guy is what he is. So
he's definitely a 2-3 guy. But absolutely, I would say Strider's the number one guy. Strider's right now. AL Coach of the Year. I talked about the Tigers win the AL Central. I think AJ Hinch wins Coach of the Year. NL side. I got Craig Counsell, for Mariner of the Year, man. Everybody talked about when he signed with the Cubs, he was the best manager in baseball, but never got a payroll like the Cubs did. He finally got that payroll, and he can finally work with superstars, man. Craig Counsell, NL Manager of the Year.
I'm going to be honest with you. I don't have anybody for any of the last four categories because I really don't know. I just don't know.
All right. So for me, AL Most Improved Player, I'm going to say Juan Soto, because what you said about him, dude, I agree. He's going to unlock some special talent in New York. Him and Juan Carlos Stanton and Aaron Judge all in the outfield.
Oh, that small Smash freaking Bros. Park, bro. He's going to kill bro. The ball over there,
314
bro.
In right field.
82
it's a ton.
Freaking games at Yankee Stadium. He's about to kill the ball, dog.
314 in right field, man. He's a donezo. He's a left-handed hitter.
It's over with. Wow, we're agreeing, bro. This is great.
We agreed on Corbin Burns. We agreed on Freddie Freeman. All right.
Yeah, he's going to
kill. Most improved in the NL. Watch out for this one, O'Neal Cruz.
Okay.
I told you when it happened. I said the White Sox screwed him over and Sebi Zavala killing him at home plate, breaking his fibula. His season was done after that.
Man.
O'Neal Cruz is a special talent, man. There's a lot of special talents in the NL Central right now.
Yeah.
You got Elly De La Cruz. You got O'Neal Cruz. I don't think they're related. You got Christian Yelich. I'm trying to say something. Balk Goldschmidt and Cody Bellinger all for those NL Central teams.
Yeah.
I think O'Neal Cruz comes back and he shows how he is that special talent.
Well, let me tell you, we'll wrap up with our final comment on TikTok here, and it's a rat says that Wanda Franco for youngest girl, he's calling it right now.
Moving on, we are going to talk about what we're most looking forward to for our teams and what we're most looking forward to for the season. All right, I would say for me, for the Cubs, I'm looking forward to Craig Counsell legit turning this team around and not having a absolute turd munkin at the head coach and not knowing what the hell he's doing with his lineup come September time. Flipping everybody around, batting Dansby in the seventh hole, batting him in the second hole, batting him in the fourth hole on a 3-day span. I want more consistency, and Counsell is that guy to give more consistency for the Cubs.
Okay.
And I feel like this team can be in the 85 to a 90 win ball club. I'm really excited about that. For the season, I can't wait to see Ohtani in the Dodgers uniform and Mookie Betts and Freddie Freeman and Tyler Glass. Now, I hate the Dodgers to a T. Like, I hate them. I hate them, man. But I'm really excited to see what baseball popularity-wise can do for the sport with Shohei in LA, with one of the most famous teams in America, with the LA Dodgers.
For sure. I think White Sox, I need to see Benintendi, Moncada, Eloy, and Luis produce. I need consistency from all four of those guys. If the rest of the team sucks, it is what it is, because we know what it is. But these four guys got to break out. This is it. Especially for Moncada, bro. He's lucky he's still on the team right now, bro. Low-key, he's lucky he's still on this roster. And so I need to see consistency from those guys. Benintendi, the largest freaking contract we've ever given. Moncada, that freaking prospect that we thought from Boston was going to be the all-NBA. Eloy, we got from your
That was part of the Chris Sale trade?
It was.
Oh, man. they swiped y'all.
Eloy, he came from y'all as well. Hurt as always. He improved last year. And Luis is the all-star, man. I need consistency from those four. If we get it, I'll be happy. And for the season, I want to see the Yankees be that top team.
I don't, man. I hate them. I literally said the same thing about the Dodgers.
I know. I hate them. But honestly, when they're in the playoffs, when they're in the postseason and they're playing Boston, or that aura of baseball gives me good memories.
Can I ask you something? Do you love when the Dallas Cowboys are in the playoffs?
It's the same thing. I know. It is the same thing. But low-key, I like it when they're in it because they don't win it.
Yeah, and then the Cowboys and Aaron Rodgers and Jordan Love are throwing four touchdowns, five touchdowns.
But I like to see the Yankees losing the postseason.
Sure, I love that too. I love it than anything. Jose Altuve, two-run homer. Chapman just smiling over there like an idiot, just allowing them to go to the World Series.
It's good stuff, bro. It's good stuff.
When we come back, WrestleMania is right over around the corner, man. If you smell...
And welcome back to the Divided Podcast here with T-Lo and G-Lee. Don't forget to hit us up on social media, Divide Pod on Instagram. Again, Divide Pod on Instagram. Then on Twitter or X, whatever you call it, Divided Podcast number 2. Again, Divided Podcast number 2. And finally, follow us on Spotify, man. We're on there. Subscribe. Weekly episodes, sports heads. Do your thing. Hit us up. We are on every week. And me and G-Lee, we entertain.
You know you have to search Twitter.com in order to get to Twitter. On a website.
Crazy, man.
It's crazy. But it's called X.
Come on, Elon. Get it
right. Figure it out. All right. Things are really heating up as we inch closer and closer to WrestleMania. Oh, yeah. I love it, man. Yeah. I love this time of year, man. Yeah. You know, it sucks that, you know, football's over. That's my favorite sport. And NBA starts to wrap up. But when WrestleMania comes around the corner, man, it's probably top three biggest event in American sports. Yeah. Super Bowl, Final Four, and WrestleMania.
Yeah, no, for sure. I mean, well, I can't say yeah, because I know a lot of people that still don't watch wrestling.
But, like, man, I've never seen Cowboy Stadium filled up to 101,000 people in one night.
I mean, I get that. I get it.
Like, I understand most people don't know a chokehold from an arm hold, but, like, still, man, like, wrestling is... When it's on, it's man.
Just, listen, as a non-wrestling fan, right, and a guy who's watched it in and out of his life and now going back to it, I definitely have been so... I've been in tune. I've watched... Listen, bro. I've been watching Raw and SmackDown during the week. That is... T-Lo doesn't watch Raw and SmackDown during the week, bro. I know what's going on.
Yeah.
I know what's happening.
It's the most exciting time for a wrestling fan.
Shout out to Robin, who's on the TikTok chat. What up, what up, what up, what up?
It's the most exciting time for a wrestling fan. Rock, Roman, Cody, and Seth will have a tag match on night one.
Yeah.
If Cody and Seth win this match, no bloodline interference in either one of their title matches. But if the Rock and Roman win, anything goes. Bloodline rules. The bloodline can do whatever they want in their title matches.
Yeah.
Rock and Cody have been going back and forth on it. Brock has been going after him on social media. F is the direction you can, you know, off is the direction you can F.
So great.
You know, like, they've been going back and forth. Rock calls out Cody's mom, calls Cody mistake, because, like, Dustin is 20 years older than Cody is. Cody calls Rock an a-hole. Cody slaps Rock.
It's must-see.
It's must-see television, man. And to so put funny. The icing on the cake, the Raw before WrestleMania in Brooklyn, everything.
The Rock's coming on, right?
Everything is going to come full circle.
Solid.
Because Rock, Roman, Cody, and Seth will be in one ring once again right before their match. Yeah. Everything is going a million miles per hour. It has been fantastic to watch.
Yeah.
How excited are you to watch WrestleMania?
I mean, I am. I followed the story, so now it means a
you're
lot more.
You're invested.
I'm invested. Hey, it's hilarious. The drama in this, bro, it's ridiculous.
It's ridiculous,
man. It's so opera status stuff. Like, you're just sitting there like, what is he going to say next? And then they're so over the top with everything.
The craziest thing is none of this happens with Vince McMahon because he would crap the bed with the whole situation.
Yeah, man. But
Triple H, man, he knows what he's working with, man.
He's good.
Some other matches that have been confirmed, Uso versus Uso, Jimmy versus Jay, brother versus brother. Oh, man.
You see their face-to-face?
Jimmy has been attacking Jay left and right. He's been screwing him out of titles. He's been screwing him out of matches. And Jimmy has just been going after Jay, and Jay's been turning the other cheek. Yeah. I think it's been fantastic. I think it was all going to come to a blow, the Raw before WrestleMania, and Jay's finally going to say his piece. Jay said a little bit on Monday, but Jimmy has just been attacking him, calling himself the older brother. And by birth, you know, he was born before Jay because they're twins, but he calls himself the older brother. Right. But he's been saying how much that he hates him, how much he despises him, how he should be an only brother and type stuff. Like, he shouldn't be a twin. And Jay's just been like, he's been going after Jimmy. But, like, I think there's going to be a boiling point because Jimmy screwed him over at SummerSlam, Jay defected over to Raw to avoid Jimmy.
Yeah.
And now Jimmy's like, you can't run from me.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
It's going to be fun.
It's going to be fun.
It's Saturday, right?
They haven't announced what night it was going to be, but it's going to be a great match. And Solo in the background can add to the drama.
Yeah.
AJ Styles versus LA Knight. I feel like this match is going to be good, but the storytelling isn't behind it as much as other matches are. I'm hoping that they can just tear the house down with their match.
Yeah, because, I mean, I guess the biggest thing was AJ coming in the Elimination Chamber that day.
Yeah, and the whole memes about AJ flew all across the world just screw over LA Knight.
But it was weird. Like, he just came out of nowhere.
It was hilarious, man. He flew across the Pacific Ocean just to screw him over.
Yeah, it was crazy.
But I hope they can have a good match, and I hope this next one can have a good match. Randy Orton, Kevin Owens, Logan Paul for the U.S. title. I hope this could be a good match. Kevin Owens and Logan Paul had a great match in the Royal Rumble. They still had that feud going in the Elimination Chamber, and Randy Orton could have had a shot at Seth Rollins, but Logan Paul screwed him over with a brass knucks, and now a triple threat match for all three of them. Thunder beat Jazz 119-107.
By the way, KSI's
he's kind of like a manager type thing. He's going to be there. I don't doubt he'll not be there.
I wanted to give him, I have my issues with him in the past in regards to his content, but he really sold that RKO. I give him props. That was really nice.
Yeah.
Good sell.
Absolutely. You should have seen the
Triple H status.
You should have seen the bump he took. You remember the bump he took against Seth?
Oh, yeah. By the broadcast booth? Yeah. That was huge.
A six-way ladder match has been announced for the tag team titles. Judgment Day versus New Day versus Awesome Truth, which is The Miz and R-Truth.
Does he cash in, bro? Is this it?
Damian Priest?
Is he cashing in?
I don't know. He's definitely not cashing in on his tag team titles. He'll cash in on a world heavyweight title.
Sure.
And DIY with Johnny Gargano and Tommaso Ciampa. Two other teams are going to be announced. I think Creed Brothers and I think Tyler Bate and Pete Dunne are going to be the other two teams announced for that. Things are setting up great for another great WrestleMania. I cannot wait. We're
going to
get the boys together. We're going
to
get some brews together.
We're
going to throw down, and we're going to watch some WrestleMania, man.
Some fake
scripted. Hey.
Oh, hold on. Wait. Let me finish my thought. Some fake scripted yet physically talented, guys,
athletes
doing crazy moves. It's a pretty cool thing.
Don't make me say, who was your favorite movie? Oh, Avengers Endgame. Oh yeah, like that existed. That's not fake. Let's move on. We're gonna move on to Avengers NBA. We're gonna move on to NBA, and we just had to play this highlight, man.
Oh man.
Oh my gosh.
Anthony Edwards. When you guys listen to this, please YouTube it if you haven't YouTubed it. This was insane. Anthony Edwards is a freaking monster. And the crazy thing is he got hurt on the same play. And the next day he played. He played the day after he got hurt on his finger. It was pretty crazy. But this dunk was we like to call it disrespectful. That's what we call this. We call this dunk disrespectful because the way he came up, he received the pass from I think it was Connolly. Just listen to it.
Had one shot attempt in that first half. Another turnover for Utah. Edwards gets it back and threw it down. And one from the rafters.
Inhumane is what that was. That was crazy.
Anthony Edwards, better pays respects to John Collins' mother because, oh my gosh.
Wow.
He put him on a murder track. That's the most vicious dunk I've seen all year.
That's crazy. That
was the best call I've ever heard. Credit to Bally, Minnesota, for that call right there. Cavaliers' Donovan Mitchell knows to miss at least 1 week. Donovan Mitchell has missed at least 7 games before because of a left knee bruise, which he received a platelet-rich plasma injection for. Yeah. So he's been dealing with a lot. Karl-Anthony Towns tore his meniscus. He is out indefinitely. That's a big miss for the Minnesota Timberwolves.
They can't catch a break, that team.
Nets announced that Ben Simmons will miss the remainder of the season as he consults with specialists and explores treatment options for his nerve impingement in his lower back.
Talk about can't catch a break.
Can't catch a ball, can't shoot a ball. Good. Ben Simmons, man. Yeah. All right, Tilo, you said you wanted to take some time and to regress.
Listen.
To get some stuff off his chest.
We're going to move into NCAA and MMA boxing to finish off the show here real quick. I got to say something for these TikTok people and for these young cats that,
oh, I already know what's going to happen,
that keep bringing up, we done with the 80s and we done with the 90s. Specifically, the disrespect to Michael Jeffrey Jordan. And right now, while you're watching this video, at the bottom or top of your screen, wherever I'm going to put it, you're looking at highlights of Jay going to his left and dominating. Let's not forget his first freaking game winner in the playoffs was him going left on Elo. The fact that you guys think Michael Jordan didn't go left is completely insane. And let's not forget that the video that's being brought up are individual clips of bad possessions. Like if no NBA player has bad possessions, I can go right now on YouTube, pick up some LeBron clips of him traveling, of him throwing some horrible passes, of him missing dunks. You got to be kidding me, bro. And the fact that you all are, oh, we done with the 90s. Oh, no, we done. Oh, unk. It is just showing how uneducated you are and how you're not looking at Mike's best moments. Because every NBA player, regardless if you're on Mount Rushmore, if you're a top 50, top 100 player, has bad moments. So I'm just done. I'm talking while you're looking at the highlights, and I'm just done. If there's anything we should do, we should make a new hashtag call. We done with the 2000s because y'all are so lost. That was it, bro.
I mean, I'm not disagreeing with you. I think the 90s were a special time for the NBA. Obviously, it was setting up for something immaculately great, and it produced the greatest player of all time. So, I mean, it's young 17 to 21-year-old kids who obviously are infatuated by guys like Giannis, like Jokic, that feel like this is superior ball play. Like
basketball's evolved. Yes, it's better now. The athlete's better now.
Kyrie Irving, Luka Doncic. Like it's just
that's not the problem. The problem with me is talking about Jordan had no left, and he wasn't the player that we all thought he was.
Didn't he go up in the NBA Finals with his right hand, switch it midair,
one of his greatest moves,
and play it up with his left?
He switched in midair, went to his left. So stop talking about he don't have no left.
Which is crazy because I feel like he didn't need to do that. He could have just went straight up and got, the bucket. But he decided to throw a little flair in there. Who cares if he didn't, man.
And Michael would dominate in today's NBA. Maybe he won't be the best player, which is fine, but he would still do numbers.
Not at his age right now, my guy.
No, I'm saying if Michael was in his prime in today's NBA, he'd be competing right there with Kyrie Irving. He'd be competing right there with all these other guys. Stop acting like Michael. The disrespect to Michael freaking Jordan is insane, bro.
All right, man. Let's calm down. We know they're young kids who are trying to get some views, who are trying to say something real crazy to get those views up and stuff like that. That's all it is.
Crazy. No, they're believing it, bro. And it's disrespectful. By the way, shout out to Spill the Beans. He said facts.
We're going to take a quick break. March doesn't just mean the NBA is going to start. It means March Madness. We'll announce our brackets next on the Vibe Podcast. Back here on Divided Podcast with G Lead and T Lo. March doesn't just mean the start of MLB season. When you think of March, you think of the next word, madness.
Look at your artistic.
March
intros,
madness has come upon us. The bracket is set. Selection Sunday has passed us. First four has begun. Wagner and Colorado State punched their tickets. Dude, Virginia absolutely was toast. They couldn't score a bucket to save their life. It was like, I think it was like 6 minutes left in the first quarter, and they didn't score until about 12 minutes into the second half. Like, it was like a legit 15-minute scoring drought for
them. This is going to be so unprofessional, G, but I'm going to tell you, I have not watched any NCAA Division I basketball this year.
Oh, dude, you're missing out because this has been one heck of a season, man. It's been one heck of a season. Grambling beat Montana State, and then right now in halftime, Colorado's up 26-24 on Boise State.
Yeah.
Fun fact for you guys, Boise State and Nebraska are the only two teams to not win an NCAA tournament game. They've been to the tournament, not win a game. Wow. Cornhuskers only lost one game at home. So, I mean, maybe they can get it done. They're a good squad, but you never know. I don't think I've been this excited for a tournament since 2021 when Oklahoma State had Cade Cunningham on the squad. Like, this team, like, that team was great. But, like, I haven't been excited for this type of tournament. It's big-time top-heavy. UNC, Houston, UConn, Purdue, Arizona, Tennessee, Iowa State, and Duke. But it's also got the lower seeds where, like, Drake, NC State, BYU, Oregon can easily make some big-time runs in this tournament. Sure. Now, I know you said in the break you haven't made your bracket yet, but I'm just going to tell you my bracket real quick. I'm only going to say the final four. So my final four, Arizona, UConn, Tennessee, and Houston. I have Houston beating Tennessee, and I have UConn beating Arizona.
Okay.
I made two brackets. I have one Houston winning it, and I have one UConn winning it. And I obviously put UConn in my $10 buy-in one because I need to win some money.
Yeah.
I need to win some
money. UConn to Final Four for sure.
Yeah. Oh, okay. My gosh. Like, they lost, I think, 3-4 of their key valuable players from last year's championship team, and they haven't missed a beat, man. Like, UConn looks this dangerous, so.
Philippines agrees with you. Houston takes it all.
I like Houston, man. My only thing is that you couldn't even get past 50 points on Iowa State, and you got dogged in the championship game. That scares me a lot for Houston. I obviously don't think that they're going to lose to a 16 seed, but, man, like, I'm really scared once they get to the Sweet 16, Elite Eight. Like, if Houston has another one of those games, like, ugh, dude. Yeah. So,
NCAA basketball's crazy.
Yeah, if you had to choose a winner right now, I'm not going to say a Final Four because you don't know the bracket, like, kind of like I do, but, like, if you had to pick a winner right now.
Con. Look at UConn.
UConn.
I'd go with UConn. They've been from what I've seen, they're the strongest team that can win it all.
Yeah.
I'm just shocked that Illinois, and I had been in and out, had won the tournament, their Big Ten tournament, and they showed me some signs of
life. Well, not outright Big Ten championship.
Right, right.
Not outright. Because I went to Purdue.
Right. Sorry, no, my live went crazy. But look for Illinois to make a semi. I think they go Sweet 16 this year, man. That's not choking. That's good.
They haven't made a Sweet 16 under the Underwood era at all. And you know what? I don't think I've said this. I hate Underwood. The dude's a snake. He came to Oklahoma State and used Oklahoma State as a freaking stepping stone to get the Illinois job.
That's gotta feel horrible.
No, that sucks, but the amount of failure he's had at Illinois just makes it so much sweeter,
I mean,
man.
You guys are not, like, your basketball program hasn't really been the greatest, right? You guys don't make Final Fours on a consistent basis, right?
Yeah, sure. We're not blue bloods like Duke, Kentucky, and stuff, but don't ever disrespect Henry Iba, the name of Henry Iba, like that again.
I mean,
don't you dare disrespect one of the godfathers of college basketball.
I mean, for sure. I just mean recently, you guys are not.
Sure, yeah. But, like, don't disrespect Oklahoma State as, like, they don't know basketball down there.
They have a good basketball culture, but you guys aren't anything to worry about.
I'm not worried about Illinois either, man.
I'm just saying.
Illinois chokes as much as the Dallas Cowboys, man.
Let's make sure you knew that.
Okay, I will say Purdue's like the Dallas Cowboys of the NCAA tournament, and I'll say Illinois is more like the Packers against the 49ers. How about that?
There you go. That's fine. We can go there.
All right, let's wrap things up with a little MMA and boxing. There's a big match to talk about in boxing, and we're going to talk about that. But Sean O'Malley defeated Marlon Vera to defend his US UFC bantamweight title and UFC 299. After the fight, he called Ilia Topuria. I probably said it wrong. Did I?
Yeah. You probably did.
Well, he's a featherweight champion, and Sean O'Malley's trying to move up a weight class to fight for the featherweight title. A little Conor McGregor, a little action. I don't know.
My head still hurts from the freaking knee. I'm just like, dude, that was insane, bro.
Yeah.
If you had surround sound and you heard that, I mean, holy cow.
Yeah.
That's why I couldn't do it.
Former bantamweight champion Petr Yan has torn his ACL and meniscus. He's going to be out for the foreseeable future. UFC World shifts his focus, Tilo, to one of the bigger, best nights when you have a 00 in your fight card. UFC 300, baby. I can't wait.
Yeah.
Pereira versus Hill, man. Hill never lost his light heavyweight title. He only lost it because he tore his Achilles last year playing basketball, man. So I'm excited. Jamal Hill, Chicago guy, man. Yeah. I'm really excited to see him get back his title. He's going to face off against Alex Pereira. That's going to be an outstanding fight. Women's strawweight title on the line with Zhang Weili and Yan Xuana. The BMF title, I think it's going to be the BMF title. I can't remember exactly, but Justin Gaethje against Max Holloway, that's still going to be a really good fight. Bo Nickel versus Cody Perange is going to be great. Armand Truscan versus Charles Oliveira. The card is so stacked that Aljamain Sterling and Holly Holm had to be in the prelims, man. The former bantamweight champion had to be in the prelims, man.
That's crazy.
I'm really excited. I know it's a couple months away, but UFC 300 is going to be awesome. I can't wait to watch it. Now we shift our sights to the last segment, to the boxing world, and Tilo, Jake Paul.
Yes.
Is set to fight Mike Tyson. 57-year-old Mike Tyson in July, Dallas, Texas, man. Tell me about this fight, man.
Just be ready for it to be scripted. It's going to end up in a draw or Jake winning by points. They're going to hug. Mike gets his bag. Jake gets his bag. And then Jake starts to train for real again.
Is it like a Logan Paul, Floyd Mayweather?
It's
where
a
there's
publicity
no,
thing, man.
It's no just, winner?
Man, there's no way they risk Mike's life, number one. And then number two, Jake's, you know, his status right now in boxing.
Sign the contract, boy.
It's just great. Great promotion. That's all it is. Ryan Garcia and Devin Haney is the fight that the boxing world is eyeing, with Ryan going, you know, going nuts on social media, posting different things, speaking some truth about the children and all this stuff. It's just, it's good. It's like promotion slash like not promotion, but it's also like what's going to happen in the fight. Is he ready to fight? It's all, everybody is going to be watching this fight. It's going to do amazing pay-per-view numbers. It's going to be close to Floyd Mayweather numbers. Just be ready for that.
Manny Pacquiao, Floyd Mayweather.
Yep.
Nice.
Lomachenko and Kambosos are going to be doing battle very soon too. If you don't know those two lightweights, those two guys box similarly, but Lomachenko's skilled better. That's a fight to look forward to as well. Canelo and Munguia just had their press conference yesterday. Canelo is talked a lot of crap about Benavidez in the post fight or post presser interviews, talking about Benavidez don't need to be sending me no numbers for the fight. I can do that, and if anything, his promoters need to come to me and give me a number. Like this crazy stuff, and everybody's like, all Canelo's avoiding Benavidez. Good stuff for promotion for later on if they ever fight. And also, finally, we have Cepeda and Inoue. They're going to be doing battle, too. Inoue is the pound-for-pound champion, in my opinion. Yeah, they got that fight going on. So there's a lot of good fights coming up for the first half of the year in 2024. So we'll see what happens. Oh, and Fury's going to defend his title with Usyk in June. So that's going to be another fight to look after as well. So,
and last thing we got to talk about, because we didn't talk about, no, this is really old, but Anthony Joshua knocking out Francis Ngannou.
Yes.
Man. Yeah, and then he called out Tyson Fury after the fight.
It was good. I mean, it was good to see, as a boxing fan, somebody knock the heck out of an MMA guy, you know, and show him what's up. But Anthony Joshua still is. I still look at him and say, bro, you've lost your two biggest fights,
If you face Fury, you have to beat him.
Or you take that rematch with Andy Ruiz, the third fight, and you make it happen.
Well, that wraps things up on the Vibe Podcast. This was our Gary Fensick episode. If we didn't get to it, this was our Gary Fensick episode. This was a hard episode for Tilo to get through. You managed to get through it.
We
so
got it. We got through
you,
it. Thank you, bro.
You got through two big trades that just absolutely devastated your heart.
Shout out to Mikey Nip, who showed in our hockey correspondence. Say something before we get out of here.
I showed up at the bell, so I don't have to actually turn in my homework right here. So I hope you guys had a great episode.
Yeah, we did.
Do me a favor. Stop posting Kaner on your freaking story with that damn Detroit Red Wings uniform. We love him, but come on, man. It's Detroit.
Yeah, start posting that Dylan Cease photo in that Padres uniform. Oh, this has been a great episode. Thank you guys for tuning in, listening. God bless, and have yourself a good one.
Peace.